Tonight on a local live, when one Larchmont resident complained about her missing mail, she was surprised at the reaction.
The Village of Mamaroneck announces its new village manager. Find out who coming up.
Mayor Rosenblum gives us an update on the Army Corps of Engineers flood mitigation project.
Local emergency vehicles are sporting patches to promote autism awareness.
A stabbing in the Village of Mamaroneck. This and other trending stories in the media.
Brave the Shave raises over $25,000 in support of childhood cancer research.
Larchmont's Sugar Mama Bake Shop is in the spotlight.
And on tonight's roundtable, we'll speak to parents, alumni, and students opposed to proposed changes to Mamaroneck High School's Apple program. Remember, you can join the conversation with your calls, emails, and tweets. Everyone, it's Thursday, March 30th. I'm Alexandra Garcia.
And I'm Rob Baez. Welcome to the Local Live.
When Adrienne Weiss Harrison complained about her mail delivery on the Love Larchmont Facebook page, she hit a nerve. Over 100 others chimed in, leading to reactions from the post office, political leaders, CBS News, The Journal News, and other online outlets. Among the complaints were missing letters, lost packages, mail left at the neighbors, and days without delivery going back years. For Eleanor Sherman, spotty service was of particular concern since she operates a business from her Murray Avenue home.
I just decided to post something on a link called nextdoor.com, Larchmont, and I said, anybody having any problems with their mail? And oh my God, it just started flooding in. Everybody was having trouble with their mail. So people were complaining and telling stories about they weren't getting mail for 5 days at a time, and they were getting other people's mail.
Larchmont Mayor Lorraine Walsh passed along complaints to State Senator George Latimer, U.S. Congressman Elliot Engel, and U.S. Senator Kirsten Gillibrand. A spokesperson for the U.S. Postal Service told the Journal News they were conducting a top-to-bottom review of operations in the area to meet customers' expectations. Residents with further concerns should call the Larchmont Post Office at 834-4963 or the Westchester District Consumer and Industry Contact Office at 697-7000 extension 0.
Mamaroneck has a new village manager, but he's a familiar face. Robert Yamuda will take over from Richard Slingerland in May, according to an announcement at this week's board meeting. Yamuda served as Mamaroneck's assistant village manager from 2002 to 2009, when he left to become Pelham Village Administrator and Treasurer. Now he's returning from Pelham, and he says he can't wait to roll up his sleeves and get started.
The flood mitigation plan proposed for the Mamaroneck and Sheldrick Rivers has passed a major milestone, but there is still a long way to go. A contingent of local officials was in Washington, D.C., as the plan was approved by the Army Corps of Engineers Civil Works Board that includes top-level engineers, staffers, planners, and scientists. Along for the review were Mayor Norman Rosenblum, trustees Leon Potok and Victor Tafor, village manager Richard Slingerland, flood committee chairman Tony Gelber, flood committee member Andrew Spatz, and planning board member John Verney.
We met last week in Washington, D.C. with the Army Corps of Engineers and the Federal Department of Accounting. Was reviewed by several different departments led by the Army Corps of Engineers. Also there was the state sponsor, which is New York State, and obviously the Village of Mamaroneck. Very quickly, after the questioning and answers back and forth in a presentation and a very strong endorsement, I would note, by Congressman Engel, who did show up, and also Senator Schuman sent a representative. And it was voted to accept the plan and make a formal presentation available to the public approximately in July of 2017, in other words, this summer. The next step would be, obviously, to go to Congress and get the funds for the engineering, which would be the next stage, and the implementation. And I can tell you, if there's any legacy that I wish to have in the Village of Mamaroneck, it would be flood mitigation.
The plan now goes to state and agency review. A final study and report is expected to be signed this summer. After that, the process can begin at the federal, state, county, and village levels to secure funding, which will take a few years. The mayor does not expect construction to start until 2020.
In honor of World Autism Awareness Day on April 2nd, The New Rochelle police issued an autism patch challenge. Their goal is to have awareness patches on every police vehicle across the country for all of April. Locally, Larchmont and Mamaroneck Fire, Police, and Ambulance vehicles are displaying the patches. The Larchmont Fire Department volunteers posted on Facebook for everyone to, quote, be on the lookout for these amazing patches.
LMC-TV Chief Operating Officer Matt Sullivan was in Albany to propose a bill to guarantee future funding for New York's public access stations.
On Wednesday, March 29th, more than a dozen community media advocates from across New York State met with lawmakers at the state capitol to discuss their concerns surrounding public, education, and government access. Spearheaded by the Alliance for Community Media New York chapter and Group Chair Anthony Arian, as well as Mark Gronich, an executive with Channel Albany, the group met with more than one dozen state lawmakers and eight key legislative aides.
Well, we had a terrific day today here up in Albany with the help of Mark Gronich. We had meetings with so many, I lost count, I think we had 23 meetings with different senators and assembly persons, and got great advice from the committees that they serve on what should go into our legislation to help protect community media and the funding streams, and include provisions for future funding streams.
We had a very informative discussion with many of the members. We were given challenges, we were told what our next steps would be, we were told what we have to do next, and we're on the road, on the path to getting parity and getting this community media well-funded in the state without putting it on the backs of state taxpayers. It doesn't have to be a budget item, which everyone is happy about, and we're just, you know, making some good headway with some legislation that's going to make a difference for community media across New York State.
For The Local Live, I'm Matt Sullivan.
Bringing us the online stories trending in the media, here is Jack Wells.
If you're looking for a fun day trip close to home this spring, you're in luck, as the Hudson Valley has a lot to offer. To view New York's history firsthand, you can visit the Sleepy Hollow Cemetery, where Elizabeth Arden, Brooke Astor, and Andrew Carnegie are buried. For the complete list of the interesting cities, visit the Patch. Also from the Patch, the Department of Labor recently announced the top turning jobs in Westchester. Ranking at number one is physical therapy, as it is the region's top growth of industry of the year. With an above average salary of $91,630, a graduate degree is needed. To check out local job opportunities and other trending jobs, visit the Patch. Good news for homeowners in Larchmont, as it now ranks as the number three most expensive zip code north of New York City. Larchmont has a median property sale price of $1.1 million, according to PropertyShark.com. For more information, check out the Patch. A stabbing took place last week in the village. Due to an argument, Ronald Guevara of Mamaroneck allegedly stabbed a 32-year-old resident of New Rochelle. He is currently held on $50,000 bail at the Westchester County Jail. For more information, visit LoHUD. New York State Common Core exams started this week for grades 3 to 8. English language arts exams concluded today, and math exams are scheduled for May 2nd to 4th. Test refusal in the past 3 years have been 5% across the state. To learn more about opting out of the exams, visit LoHUD. And that's it for this week's In the Media. I'm Jack Wells.
Coming up next, parents, alumni, and students join Mike Witch to talk about their opposition to the redesign of the Apple program. But first, it's time for our local trivia.
Good evening and welcome to the round table. The Mamaroneck School Superintendent proposes to redesign the Apple program at Mamaroneck High School. He explained his ideas to the Board of Education in his proposed budget for the next school year. Many Apple parents, alumni, and current students are opposed to this change. Last week, we hosted a discussion with school officials in which they explained the redesign and why it's being proposed. Several viewers called or emailed their questions, which I then asked our guests. You can watch that program online at lmctv.org. This week, we welcome some of the parents and students who want the Board of Education to keep the Apple program as is. An online petition now has 668 supporters and 147 alumni supporters, including me. As a retired MHS teacher, I knew about A.P.P.L.E. and thought it was a worthwhile program. That said, tonight I'm a journalist, and my opinion will not be part of the discussion. Instead, we'll hear from Lisa Zeitoun and Katrina Reda. Both are parents of students in A.P.P.L.E. and two students currently enrolled in the A.P.P.L.E. program, Romina Chavez and Travis Danoski. Sorry, I mispronounced that. Well, welcome to the four of you, and thank you for coming on board. And let me ask Travis a first question. You started this petition on change.org,
yes.
I think 2 days after the superintendent proposed his budget. So what did you hope to accomplish?
Well, overall, I attempted to accomplish saving the A.P.P.L.E. program. That was the main objective. From the first second that I heard the news, I knew that somebody was going to have to make a difference and somebody was going to have to step up and at least attempt to save it. Knowing that I was an A.P.P.L.E. senior, I felt I had an obligation because these teachers have helped me through my 4 years of high school, and I knew without them it would not have been possible. So when I first started writing the petition, I knew instantly that it would be perfect because I immediately spoke from the heart and I wrote everything from the top of my head, and as soon as I wrote it, I knew that it was going to get a bunch of supporters because I know that the 2,000 previous students felt exactly the same way that I did.
Well, for our viewers who may not know about A.P.P.L.E., Lisa, could you give us a quick description of the A.P.P.L.E. program? Now, you have a daughter who is in A.P.P.L.E.
Yes, I do. I'm the proud mother of a junior in the A.P.P.L.E. program.
And she's with us tonight in the studio.
She is. And first thing I want to do is to explain the acronym. A.P.P.L.E. stands for A Place People Learn Excellence. Mm-hmm. It is an alternative high school at the Mamaroneck High School. It is a school within the school. It is a small program for children who are academically and socially vulnerable, children who tend to be non-traditional learners. These are not special ed students, although some of these students may have 504s or IEPs.
And for people who are not parents familiar with that, those are designations for students who have special needs.
That's correct. The beauty of A.P.P.L.E. is that it is a small program where children who had first started out in main school and were floundering were interviewed and given the opportunity to decide whether or not this is something that they would like for themselves. So everybody who's in A.P.P.L.E. is there by choice, and they stay on their own free will. They're allowed to leave the program and go back to main school if they think that they're ready and this is something that they would like to do. But A.P.P.L.E. is very structured, and some of these students work much better in a very structured environment where there are teachers who know each of them as learners and personally. Mm-hmm. And it's a collective mission of all these teachers to make sure that these children can succeed. In the much larger Mamaroneck High School environment, it's very difficult for some of these students. And for us, it has been a blessing.
I read some of the comments that were on the change.org site, and many of them are, as you described them, heartfelt comments. And we actually had three A.P.P.L.E. alumni who came into our studio and asked that their feelings be recorded. So we're going to continue our conversation, but I'd like the control room to roll that video, please.
Having a little bit of difficulty kind of keeping up with the rest of the class in my main school classes. Once I ended up in the A.P.P.L.E. program, I quickly saw that there was an immense amount of structure, teachers who greatly care, and now I'm the head of the Scarsdale Public TV cable office, and I own my own business.
Joining the A.P.P.L.E. program saved my life at the time just because I was failing in school. I didn't know where to turn. I didn't know who to turn to, tutors, teachers. I didn't feel comfortable at all, so I would have just kept failing, or I wouldn't say failing, but struggling. And then the A.P.P.L.E. program really provided that gateway for me to go into a community that really helped me and allowed me to feel comfortable enough to challenge myself academically and not just give up.
There are some claims that there's 48% of the children who go to Apple, who leave Apple and go into the main school. I see this as a success of Apple, not a failure, because these kids feel confident to be launched into the main school.
Those are interesting comments, no doubt. And let me ask you, Katrina, did you take a look at the findings that that the superintendent presented, and what did you think of that program review?
I did. I had a lot of issues with a lot of them. I felt some of them were contradictory. I mean, he always, in discussing the findings, mm-hmm. Dr. Shapps always started with, it's been a successful program for 40 years. And I feel anything said after that really doesn't make any sense. It has been a very successful program. You know, one of the issues was about kids not staying in the program, and
that some of them weren't there for the whole
four years.
Yes.
And I feel that just stating that without finding out where these kids went, were they mm-hmm. successful, did they leave and go to private school, really doesn't give us a feel for why that would be important or why that would be a reason to cancel the program.
And another thing that he complimented the family atmosphere.
Yeah.
That was evident on some of the comments that we heard tonight, and also on some that were written about on change.org.
Yeah, I mean, my son has gotten very close with all of his teachers. He, in freshman year, he often woke up and said, I have a stomachache, I don't feel well, I don't want to go to school. I can tell you, of the few times that he hasn't been in school since he joined Apple, he has been very sick. He mm-hmm. never doesn't want to go to school. He really, truly enjoys being there, and he's doing very well. You know, he's doing well on his regents. Before Apple, we were constantly fighting about homework, fighting about studying. They take care of all of that, and they help them and make the kids, you know, it's not that they force them to do it. It really changes the kids' attitudes towards school, mm-hmm. and it makes them want to do it and want to be accountable for their work. Mm-hmm. And it's a big advantage to a lot of children.
Romy, can you tell us about your experience in the Apple program?
Well, I got really close to my teachers. They're great people. They helped me a lot with my academics and also as a person. I was a shy girl since freshman year, but when I joined Apple, they helped me a lot getting better. And I feel like without Apple, I wouldn't have been able to do a lot of things, such as be the captain of the volleyball team, be the president of the Spanish club, or being in the honor society. I wouldn't have been able to do all these things without them. And yeah.
So it helped you with self-confidence?
Yes, a lot.
In the study that I read, which is available on the district's website, they do talk about their dedication to helping every individual student meet his or her objectives and goals and graduation and training for a post-high school career. Do you think that the recommendations that they've made are so different than the program as it exists now?
Well, the term that Dr. Shapps is using is redesign, and actually it's an elimination. That's what the children were told. 2 weeks ago, they were told in school, without any prior knowledge given to the parents or any discussion with the parents, that as of June, the Apple program was going to be eliminated. So he may, to the public, be using the word redesign, but it's a question of basically eliminating Apple as it exists.
In the proposed budget, they do stipulate staff reductions of one English teacher, one social studies teacher, one math teacher, and one science teacher, and one part-time director of
right.
Apple.
So all of those teachers, from mm-hmm. what we understand, are going to be absorbed back into the main school because mm-hmm. they're all tenured, except, I believe, for one. So it was very vague when we read it. But then, you know, after the children were informed, and then we received a letter, and several days after the children were informed, a letter, again, that was pretty vague. But then the following week, we were invited to a meeting to sit down with Dr. Shapps and Ms. Klain. And, you know, it came to light that what they really want to do is to eliminate this program, to bring in one full-time psychologist, thinking that these children in Apple really need therapeutic intervention as well, although most of them go to Ms. Sherwood, who's the coordinator, who mm-hmm. is like a second mother to most of them.
This is Linda Sherwood, who's right? a longtime English teacher.
And
there.
Also, they're all very close with their core teachers, because these are the teachers who follow them from freshman year through senior year. So these teachers get to know who they are as students and who they are as people. So when these children have an issue, those are the people to whom they go. So the premise is that these children need greater therapeutic intervention, as do some of the other students in main school. Mm-hmm. So the idea is to have one new time psychologist
right.
following not only all the children in Apple, but the 400 per grade students in the main school. To me, that just doesn't seem like it's a tenable arrangement.
His proposal also has here an academic liaison and a social worker, and that's a part-time social worker.
Which they already do have.
Liaison, and he refers to the Apple suite, located in the Apple suite. So I would imagine they intend to keep some physical identification where students can
Correct.
Go.
But these students who have difficulty going from Palmer to Post. Mm-hmm.
And for some people who don't know,
right,
Mamaroneck High School is a huge school.
It's yes. huge. So, you know, for these students, that's a challenge, mm-hmm. whereas having all of their core courses in this small environment makes it so much easier for them not to get lost in the halls and maybe not make it to class. So, you know, for them, that was a struggle mm-hmm. for them in freshman year, and it will become a struggle again mm-hmm. Once they're put back into main school.
Travis, how do you react to the thought that the school district is saying that the people in Apple may need more therapeutic help than academic support?
Well, as a student and growing up in Mamaroneck, mm-hmm. I found that in my situation, because I moved here since the second grade, mm-hmm. it was a big change for me, and being in Apple was probably the best decision that I've ever made. From my point in elementary school till now, I have not had the best grades, best attendance, but I'm the most heartfelt person you might have ever met. And without Apple and without the people in Apple, yeah. most importantly, they were the ones who most supported me.
Yeah.
But without it, it would be not the best school.
Yeah. So Romy, your experience, if the school had a full-time psychologist or a full-time youth liaison, as they're calling it, is that really different from the experience that you have day to day at the high school?
Not really. For me, who helped me a lot were the teachers, Ms. Sherwood, Ms. Kapp, and the social worker.
So that would be a big difference then.
Yeah. It's like taking
because they wouldn't have your core teachers. They would just have the therapeutic people, and maybe the liaison would help you if you needed homework assistance or you were dealing with some issue. But the teachers are what makes the big difference for you.
For me, yeah.
Yeah.
One thing that I would also like the community to know is that Apple mirrors main school in terms of requirements. So mm-hmm. these children are graduating with the same Regents diploma as children in the main school. But these mm-hmm. are just children who do better in a small, nurturing environment.
Was that always the case with Apple? Do you know?
Well, my understanding is that
40 years goes back a long
right,
way.
Right. No,
I don't know.
I did some research because mm-hmm. one of the things I want to rebut is a statement made by Dr. Shapps that Apple is at only 70% capacity. That was one of mm-hmm. the other issues that he brought up.
Yeah, he said it was designed for 16 students per year.
Well, actually, historically, it was designed for 10 to 12 students per year. And research shows that the optimum number in alternative high school classes is 10 to 12. And something that I would like the community to know as well is that there was an article in the March 2015 issue of Westchester Magazine entitled "The Best Alternative High School Programs in Westchester." And one of the first points that it makes is that class size matters. And that class size can make a very big difference, not only in grades, but in motivation and self-confidence, which is something we're hearing from these students. And
The other thing I would like the community
to know is that in our neighboring towns, such as Scarsdale, Edgemont, Rye, Hastings, Ardsley, Pleasantville, and Yorktown, as well as Chappaqua, there are alternative high school programs that people clamor to get their children into. We think that Apple has a little bit of a stigma because it's not very well advertised. I think it's a precious gem, and I think that if more people knew about it, then maybe there can be a few more students in there, though, again, I think 10 to 12 is, you know, is an optimal number.
Travis, how did you hear about Apple? You made the decision to enroll.
Yes, based off of...
Nobody pulled you in and said, you're in this program, kid.
Well, not exactly. My brother really pushed me to join.
And I think we saw your brother on camera a little while ago.
I'm sorry. I actually have two brothers.
Okay.
Another one actually has graduated from St. John's University.
Uh-huh. Good.
He was not in the Apple program, but he knew that I definitely needed the extra assistance. So nobody really pushed me to join. I was actually a little intimidated by it because of what the students would say about it, how it's not necessarily graduating high school because it's a little bit easier.
So but it did have a little bit of a stigma, as Lisa said. Yeah. Okay.
But overall, as soon as I joined, I realized that it was nothing like that. It was just a place that people needed extra help and you were given it.
Romy, let me ask you a question, and I should remind our audience that you can call in or send a tweet or an email. And I've got an email here that just came in from a viewer who says, what do students fear most if Apple is eliminated? And what would you do? Or what will you do?
I guess it's our future in school. Because, like I said before, Apple is a great program that helps us a lot with school. If you need help, the teacher's always there for you. She has time for you to explain things to you. And that's something that main school, you can't find it. And I need a lot of help in school. I always ask my teacher for everything, if they could help me, if they could explain things, and they always do. And I feel like that in main school, I won't be able to find it. Teachers, it's a bigger class. I feel like I'll be shy. I won't participate. And it's just the class number. It's
yeah. Katrina, let me ask you a question that came in earlier before the show started. This viewer says, has anyone discussed or suggested letting the current students finish high school in the Apple program and then terminate the present format for new students? And if so, what was the district's response to that?
So several parents at the meeting asked that. You know, when my son called me the first day when he found out, I said to him, you know, he was crying hysterically, as were several other children I heard from parents that were crying, calling their parents in the middle of the day to let them know that they heard this news. And I said, well, don't worry about it. They're going to, you know, you have one more year. They're going to let you graduate. And he said, it is done as of June. Several parents asked Dr. Shapps, and when somebody really pushed him to answer, his only answer was that it was not feasible. He's been asked to explain why it's not feasible. They are saying that all the teachers are staying in the school. So in my thought, I mean, for me, I graduated from Mamaroneck High School. I was not in the Apple program, but I know people who were. I know more people now in the community who graduated from the Apple program. And I'm not sure why, if the teachers are staying in the school, why they couldn't just phase it out for those students, have those students, maybe even only the junior class, maybe the freshmen and sophomores have time to adjust to the new program. But I feel like the juniors, we're already at almost April. The school year is almost over, and then they have senior year. If they are going to try something, basically it's trial and error. There's no time for these students as seniors. If they're going to keep all these teachers in the school, why could they not teach these kids and then teach in main school as well in the same day? You know, there were many, many times he was asked, you know, is it budget? He said it was not a budget issue. But again, it was just not feasible, was the answer. So they're proposing a lot of things, but to me, they don't make sense. One of the things they were proposing is more co-taught classes, but right in the budget, there's a reduction of one special ed teacher at the high school, and the rationale is a reduction in the number of co-taught classes. So that right there is contradictory. They're proposing tailoring to individuals' needs, but again, like I said, for the juniors who are seniors next year, there's just not time for that.
Let me hold you there for a second. We have a caller on the phone. This is Brian. Brian, go ahead. You're live on the local live. Go ahead, Brian.
Hi.
Hello.
How are you?
We're just fine. What's your question or comment?
My question and comment was, I'm actually watching the live video, and my concern was, and I think Lisa did a great job of stating that Dr. Schapp said it's been a very successful program for 40 years. And the fact that it's been a successful program for 40 years consistently makes me really kind of get the thought that there's other alternatives or motives to get rid of the Apple program other than the direct success that it's had. So I just kind of want to get to the root of that and find out the real issues. Because if there's nothing but success, then what's the, why is it being taken away?
Okay. Do any of you have suspicions of other motives that have not been articulated yet by the school district?
I do not.
No? Katrina, you were saying that you haven't got a satisfactory answer to even the phase-out idea.
You know, we did ask several times, and it's like I said, you know, Dr. Schapp starts all the conversations with it has been successful, and it's not a budget issue. He has, I know, Lisa, one of the things I think that you wanted to talk about was he, one of his comments was that the high school graduation rate is on par with the main school, but the college graduation rate is not.
Yes. Brian, thank you for your phone call. We appreciate you viewing and calling. And anybody still out there with a question or a comment, our information, our contact information is on the screen, and we've got a few more minutes to go here. So one of the findings in that study was that the post-secondary graduation rate was not as high as in the regular school. In other words, the number of Apple students who pursue college but don't finish it was not as high as the regular school.
Right, but in a recent article in the Wall Street Journal, Mark Kantrowitz, who's a financial expert, talked about the fact that the average 2016 college graduate left college with greater than a $37,000 debt. Okay, so for you know, many people in this community. You know, that
there may be other reasons why they're not finishing college.
We also know that a college degree does not guarantee a good job or a bright future, or how do we define success? And also, there are many people who are very happy being in the uniform service. And I also feel that the responsibility of my community, as someone who's a taxpaying homeowner, is to make sure that kindergarten through 12th grade is very successful for each child. I don't think it's the responsibility of the superintendent to really worry about or need to worry about children once they're in college. And the other thing is, we also know that that from other studies that almost half of all students entering college drop out before getting a degree. And those who do get degrees nowadays average more than 4 years of study. And this is actually from a psychologist by the name of Jeffrey Arnett, who wrote Emerging Adults in America, Coming of Age in the 21st Century. So I don't want Apple students to feel that you know, their success at college is going to be limited by the fact that they're an Apple. Mm-hmm. You know, I think that, you know, based on, you know, these readings, you know, college is a struggle, you know, for many yeah. different reasons.
I just want to go back to Travis and Romy for a second. I think you mentioned this earlier, but this viewer asks, is it true that students heard about this redesign during school and without any warning and before the parents knew about it? And did you think this was insensitive to you?
Absolutely. I was also informed that the teachers were also notified at a very close time to
not
now.
Not too far before.
Yes, yeah. And that is absolutely unreasonable to not even give the people who feel they're making a difference in this alternative program to try and save it.
And how did it make you feel personally, Romy?
I was really sad and I was scared. And just like the other students, there were people crying, people yelling, and it was really sad. And I don't think, they should have waited more time.
Yeah.
At least through last year.
I understand we have a caller on the line, but we're not quite ready to take that call yet. So let me, we're ready now. And this is Ariella on the phone. Ariella, welcome to the Local Live, and you are on the air. What is your question or comment? Ariella, can you hear me?
Yeah.
You go ahead, please.
I just want the students to explain really how Apple is a big family besides the fact that we get assistance in our education. And I just want Travis to explain the fact that all of his siblings were in Apple, and it not only brought us closer as a family, but we made a family out of Apple, and we know that no matter what, even if Apple does close, we still all have each other's backs no matter what.
Okay, well, thank you. And Travis, you've got a comment to make about that?
Well, that's actually my sister that mm-hmm. was on the phone. Being in Apple together, that was actually the main reason that I joined it. Mm-hmm. I grew up with like a lot of separation anxiety, as maybe many other students have. So to be with my family on top of this new family that I've been brought into,
sure.
it was probably the most comfort I've ever experienced throughout my life. I don't know if this really has a connection, but when I was young, my father passed away. Mm-hmm. And being in Apple, it really felt like I had an addition to my family. Especially with the male teachers, they really gave me a sense of direction in life, and they are most definitely one of my top role models.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you, Ariella, and I'm sure you didn't pay her to make that call.
Absolutely not.
Okay. One of the things that really moved me was when I read some of the comments that were made by people who signed on your petition. My brother would not have graduated Mamaroneck High School. That was a common statement. Here's another person who says, it helped countless numbers of people who learned differently than the majority of students. MHS has a long history of teaching a wide variety of students, all according to their needs. And this person concludes, we are one of the wealthiest communities in the U.S., yet are considering this program due to what? And then another person said, there is no one-size-fits-all education solution. And this thoughtfully focused program provided a rich educational growth for students in our district. As a community, we support giving opportunity, attention, time, resources, and dedicated, talented teachers to all learners. Please save the Apple program. And there are dozens of others that are similar to it. That must make you feel pretty good that you've generated a lot of positivity.
Well, ideally, I would definitely like to think it was me, but it was actually the people who have kept Apple going for the past 40 years. Most definitely, that is the absolute reason why I would like to save the Apple program. Mm-hmm. I do like the fact that it is a secondary school for kids in need, mm-hmm. but the teachers at Apple really feel like they make the biggest difference in the Mamaroneck community, and to take that away from them is really an emotional problem rather than a financial problem, and that's where I think we draw the line between the Board of Education and the superintendent mm-hmm. because they're looking at it, I feel, as from a financial aspect rather than an emotional one. Mm-hmm. And the really only way to make a connection between us would be for them to be affected by this decision in an emotional way, as in maybe a family member. But until then, I feel like they have no connection to the students.
I think maybe reading the responses on the petition has had an impact on them. But in any event, we have somebody whose name is Brian, and he's on the phone with us, and he's got a statement. Brian, welcome to the Local Live, and please go ahead with your statement.
Hi, I just have one comment and one question to follow. My name is Brian Danoski, and I called before. The comment is, I just kind of would like Travis, if possible, if you guys have time, to kind of elaborate on the fact that how passionate Travis, Ariel, and myself are, because we're all brothers and sisters, and where we came from and how the Apple program has helped us and where we are now. But my question is mainly, what if one of these potential Apple students or prospective future Apple students ends up being one of the students or people that end up changing the world in the long term, or potentially one of the next presidents of the United States? Because I doubt Obama was in high school thinking, I'm going to be the next president, and I'm not going to be the next president. But who's to say that these kids wouldn't develop themselves to that extent due to the Apple program alone? So that alone, to me, stands as just enough value to keep the program alive.
Thank you, Brian. You're on again, Travis.
Since I'm famous. Well, as my brother said, to deny students who really need the help for an opportunity for education mm-hmm. is not good at all, especially when I see many of my friends in the mainstream thriving in their classwork and all their tests and projects. I feel like I'm not equal to them in a sense because of all the comments and being told that I'm not doing my best, I'm not working my hardest, but overall my passion for school was never great. Mm-hmm. The idea of waking up for school was horrendous. But as soon as I joined the Apple program and made an immediate connection with the teachers, that instantly went away, as said by the
motivation. Yeah. Motivation.
Motivation
yes.
was definitely given. Passion for school has definitely went up. My grades have went up. Mm-hmm. And overall, I'd like to say that without Apple, I would most definitely not be graduating this year.
Would you like to announce your candidacy for a position on the Supreme Court or president or anything like that? At this point, no pressure.
So far, I'm okay with owning my own business.
That's admirable, and I don't mean to be making any joke about this at all. Thank you. Lisa, you wanted to say something here.
Yes, we talked about the possibility of a transition. Mm-hmm. You know, my feeling about it is, yes, that is definitely something that should be out there on the table while they redesign it and make it even better. My daughter is going to be graduating, mm-hmm. but I am still going to be living in this community. And I think that when people are looking for homes, they're also very interested in what the school system can offer. And I mentioned all those alternative high mm-hmm. schools in neighboring towns. I think that Apple needs to continue, you know, for those of us who, you know, pay taxes and, you know, and also because we have seen what Apple has been able to do for our children.
Sure.
So I say let's transition and make it better. I look at the special ed department within the Mamaroneck High School, and that's a shining star. Apple could be that way, and I'm thinking that one of the reasons why special ed, you know, has been so successful is that it has a very powerful parents association behind it, SEPTA. So I just earlier today, I thought what Apple needs is an Apple PTA, so that the word could get out there that this is a program available to, you know, any student who may not be a traditional learner, and to see it be even more successful than it has been. But I don't want it to be transitioned out.
And you had I think we answered this question earlier, but a viewer has emailed in a question, is this a budget issue? And can we fundraise more to save Apple? But I think the superintendent has claimed that it is not budgetary.
Right.
No. Of course, if they were to keep those five teachers, then I would imagine they have to add five teachers to the staff, or maybe not.
I asked about that because on the budget summary, mm-hmm. they're in the deductions, but there yes. are no additions. Mm-hmm. And he said, you know, there are teachers throughout the community for whatever reason retiring or leaving yes. the district, and it's balancing
it
out those teachers.
Out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So okay. it's still really unclear what the motive is.
We have a question that came in. I heard it through my little earpiece here, and that's what can people do to help you folks make the point to the board to save the program? One of the points that was made last week was that the superintendent gets to propose his budget, but then the Board of Education listens to the community and other stakeholders, and they don't necessarily follow everything that the superintendent recommends. They will adopt a budget in April, I believe, and that's the budget that people will vote on
yes,
May 16th.
On May 16th.
But at this point, what can people do to influence the Board of Education to save the program or phase it out as opposed to, not phase it out, but change it?
Well, there's a school board meeting this coming Tuesday,
mm-hmm.
So I would ask as many people from the community to come and show support for the Apple program. People could go online to change.org and search for Travis Danoski and mm-hmm. sign his petition.
When I went on change.org, I questioned Apple MHS, and it took me directly to
it. Oh, okay.
I didn't need to remember
your
name.
Okay, thank you.
And for those people who can't make the meeting or want to, can they send a letter? Assuming
they
can.
Mm-hmm. Yes, to the school board.
Mm-hmm.
They read all of the letters. I believe it's board@mamaroneckschools.org.
I think the instructions are on the website.
Okay,
I don't know exactly what that site
yes.
is. I was going to ask if there are times set aside during a regular board meeting for anybody to address issues before the board, or do you have to be on the agenda ahead of time, or
no.
you just show up?
Yeah, they do open it up to the public.
Okay.
Last week there were several Apple alumni who came.
Mm-hmm.
I was very impressed with the people who came. We had a social studies teacher from Portchester High School who said he didn't know where he would have been, and he said, quite frankly, I don't want to know where I would have been without this program. Mm-hmm. He's been a social studies teacher for 25 years. And he said he uses the things that he learned in Apple every day. There were several teachers that came. There were, I believe, special education teachers.
Mm-hmm. These were all Apple graduates.
All Apple graduates, very successful Apple graduates. And one of the things, I got up and spoke, one of the things that I said was, you know, within the few days following the news, I heard and saw through social media literally hundreds of comments from people mm. who all had very, very dramatic statements to make about the program. As you said, they don't know where they would have been. They wouldn't have graduated. I mean, someone as far to say that they don't know if they would be alive if it wasn't for the Apple program. It was a very, and these are people in our community. There's police officers and firemen who are Apple graduates, many teachers. You know, many people that still live here in the community are raising their kids here,
mm-hmm.
and it is a very vital program which has been very successful for a long time. One of the other things that I felt was important was just to reiterate that the children who are in this program started in the main school. They went their first semester freshman year to the main school, and you know, these kids weren't ignored. The school tried in their capacity to help them, and it didn't work. All of these kids now in the Apple program have been successful. To put them back into main school where they've already attempted success that didn't work, it just seems irresponsible. The other thing was that they said, as you mentioned, that there will be a full-time social worker mm-hmm. there for them to go talk to. Not all of the kids are having issues that they need to speak about. With my son, there was no motivation. It was, you know, as Travis said, he just didn't want to do it. And his teachers would say, you know, he's a good kid, and he, you know, is embarrassed when he doesn't do his work because he knows he should be doing it. He's not, it's not that he doesn't care, but he just wouldn't do it.
And he's got the relationship
and
with those teachers.
Now he, like I said, he loves going to school. He has that relationship. And another thing that was from before high school, when he was younger, his teachers would say, he's very smart, but he doesn't like to speak up in class. And when I would ask him about it, he said, I'm scared, I would be scared to be wrong. And when they're in such small groups and they get so close with their teachers and not only their fellow students, that goes away.
Makes
they
a
don't
big
have
difference.
That. They really are more outgoing and more confident, and it affects their schoolwork.
I want to see if we can squeeze in one more comment from Ariella on the phone. Ariella, can you make it quick, please?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
I just want to make a comment to Ms. Reda. I'm not really sure if I pronounced it right, so I'm sorry. But my first semester of college, I actually finished with a 3.6 GPA and made the dean's list, all because of Apple and the things it taught me. And I just want Romy to explain how being a student athlete and being in Apple has really met her expectations to living in high school, because we constantly get comments that Apple is secluded and we don't associate ourselves with other people and main school.
Okay, Ariella, thank you. And we're running up against a deadline here. Can you do that in 30 seconds?
So not true. We have the choice to go out in main school and do programs, clubs, and sports. And when I was playing volleyball, the teachers from Apple will go see my games. My friends from Apple will see my games, and they just show me a lot of support. And Ariella too. They went on her senior day, and it's really good. It's a great feeling.
Well, on that note, it's a great feeling. I think we'll conclude this conversation. Thank you all for coming
Thank
out
you
tonight.
So
and folks, we have more of the local live coming up right now, so please stay tuned.
And now, reporter Xavier Campo has a story on how Brave the Shave raised thousands for cancer research.
This is Xavier Campo, and we are here at Mamaroneck for the first annual St. Baldrick's Foundation's Brave the Shave Head Shaving fundraiser. Members of our community showed compassion and solidarity for children who are battling childhood cancer by shaving their heads last Saturday.
Let me ask you, Phil, how does it feel to get your head shaved right now?
Well, for a good cause, it feels great.
Stephen Carty, the owner of Molly Spillane's, has been hosting the Brave the Shave event at Mickey Spillane's in Eastchester for several years. And he has now brought this cause to the Mamaroneck community.
It goes back about 8 years ago in Mickey Spillane's in Eastchester. I started running this event. And in those 8 years, we raised over 300,000 for kids' cancer research. All over the Spillane group, which is Mickey's, Molly's, Maggie's, given to where we're living. We believe in that.
In the U.S. alone, more children die from cancer than any other childhood diseases. But with the money raised from St. Baldrick's Foundation for Cancer Research, they hope for new treatments. 10-year-old Margie Sheeker, a resident of Larchmont, is a cancer survivor. She was the honored guest of the event.
Now I feel so great that I'm out of the hospital.
You are a champion.
All the support, especially the guy was giving me, saying that I'm his hero and saying I'm really lucky, I thought that that was pretty nice.
Cancer doesn't discriminate, and it can touch all of us. And so I just think it's important to stay a part of the community and accept help and love from others.
I think when it comes to events like this, I always think of a Tony Robbins quote, that the secret to living is giving. And I would do this every day and twice on Sunday for free.
Since 1999, the St. Baldrick's head shaving event has grown nationwide, raising more than $200 million. Hairstylists from the Lemon Tree in Mamaroneck donated their time and positive energy at this fundraiser.
So this was at least 6 months planning in the works,
getting all the committee together, getting people to sign up, getting all the barbers, just everything in the works. A lot of time, a lot of effort.
The St. Boldrick's Foundation believes every child should not only survive, but thrive. So a very special thanks to Molly Spillanes, the community of Mamaroneck, and all the people who came out to shave their heads and raise over a whopping $25,000 for tonight's event. This is Xavier Campbell for The Local Live, signing off.
Sugar Mama Bake Shop in Larchmont specializes in custom cookies, cakes, and desserts for all of life's occasions. I got to join in on the decorating fun. Do you have a sweet tooth like I do? If so, then you want to come to Sugar Mama by Kim in Larchmont, where everything is baked with fresh, all-natural ingredients for you and your family. If you're in the Larchmont area, make sure to stop by Sugar Mama by Kim, where you'll find a very cozy atmosphere along with some colorful Easter goodies on display.
When I was 13 years old, I started baking, and I worked with my neighbor who was, she catered, and she had a kitchen in her home that she did everything out of, and she taught me basically how to do everything. And I started from there, and I just, at 13 years old, I wanted a KitchenAid mixer, like that was what I wanted, and I've been baking ever since.
Head cake decorator Laura Soriano taught me how to make flowers for their very popular rosette cake. Afterwards, I applied some edible disco dust to highlight the cake, which was my favorite part of all. After decorating the rosette cake, Kim explained to me that her main department is decorative custom cookies. Customization has always been her utmost focus for her clients.
Like I said, we're doing ones right now for Spectrum, which are going to the Dodgers. So we do a lot of corporate events, which is a lot of huge orders, big cookies. So that's my department.
Why do you think it has become such a hit in Larchmont?
I think because of the customization of everything that we do. If somebody wants a specific cake, we can customize it so that it's exactly what they want. If they want a specific cookie that says, you know, happy 65th birthday, or, you know, we can do that. So, you know, it makes everything more personal.
Whether it's a birthday party or family gathering, make sure to place your order for that special day at Sugar Mama by Kim in Larchmont. You will not regret it. Now look at this cake. This was the cake that I learned on. I did some flowers on it, but of course the cake decorator took over. And if you want a cake like this for your special occasion, make sure to place your order today. Reporting for The Local Live, I'm Alexandra Garcia. This week, we have two furry friends looking for a home. Sherry is a beautiful two-year-old tuxedo who loves to be brushed, a purring machine. She aspires to be the cat on your lap. Roscoe is a handsome cattle-dog mix, around 4 years old and under 50 pounds. He loves long walks and would thrive as an only pooch. Come meet him and fall in love. For more on adopting Sherry or Roscoe, visit ny-petrescue.org. Remember, to help keep us on the air, make an online donation. Go to www.lmctv.org and click on the donate button in the upper right corner. We really appreciate the help.
We always welcome new volunteers and interns. We love to hear from you. So send an email to localive@lmctv.org and join our crew. Thank you so much for watching our show. That's all for tonight. I'm Rob Baez.
And I'm Alexandra Garcia. See you next week for another episode of The Local Live.